Hello and welcome, Meta and Lars. Today we'll talk about adaptation and evolution of bacteria. I'd like to start asking you, Lars. Bacteria, are they everywhere? Is there any specific place?
I would say that you find bacteria everywhere. In nature, in the most extreme environments, you can find bacteria, and you will find bacteria essentially all places in and on our bodies as well. So you find them everywhere.
Okay. Meta, so as Lars said, we find bacteria in the environment, in and on in our body. But do they behave the same way, depending on where they are? Maybe the same species?
No, definitely not. They adapt very much to the environment they are in. And there are different ways of adapting, and that can be either by changing over time into a specific type. So that's called evolution, where they evolve and become specialists. But you can also have a lot of gene regulation leading to different phenotypes in a specific environment or in an environment where you have changes. So if you have one condition, then the bacteria need to adapt to that. But if the conditions change, they need to be quick and make a lot of changes. And that depends on gene regulation. So they definitely have what we call phenotypic plasticity. That is that they can adapt to different conditions and change quickly.
Okay. So what we learned in this course already that bacteria like to live in biofunctional groups, but out also in nature. Are they lonely wolves, or do they live all in these biofilms? And does it matter? Does it matter how many species there are?
I think it's you can maybe turn it around and say that much of what we know today about bacterial physiology, genetics, metabolism, and so on, we know that from single strains that we grow up in the lab, single species and so on. But I don't think that reflects necessarily what goes on in nature. That's much more complicated. Bacteria will be in close proximity to other bacteria, for example in biofilms, but also in food webs and so on. So they sort of depend on each other. They're not living life necessarily on their own. The environment that they live in is also manipulated by other bacteria and so on. Mm-hmm. So I think the community context, thinking about bacteria that they live in a community is something that we need to understand or deal with.
Okay. So, and if they live in these communities and different species maybe, do they collaborate or can they fight each other and maybe both?
I think definitely they are doing both. I think there's a lot of debate at the moment actually going on about whether bacteria of different species collaborate or compete. So within a species it's getting accepted now that there's a lot of social interactions going on, so they can actually collaborate and do what we call social behaviors. But whether that can also occur between species, that's sort of a strong debate at the moment. And I personally definitely think that you can have different species cooperating. They are very different, and they, in many cases, can develop dependencies of each other so that they both provide something that the other will give. But the true sort of evolutionary theory is just thinking about the survival of the fittest will not predict that. They will predict that one will always be fitter than the other and outcompete it. So that's actually where you have the contrasting views at the moment.
Mm-hmm. So building on that, we have natural microbiota, natural places for bacteria like in the guts and in the oral cavity, on the skin. And in the course we talked about that this helps to fight away other bacteria so we don't get sick. But can a new microbiota, maybe an infection, can that arise in the human body, maybe?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think we know from a lot of genome surveys, we do a lot of metagenomic sequencing of different body sites and so on to see the diversity of bacteria that we have there. And we know that the composition of these communities in our gut, for example, is correlated with, for example, different disease types. So the community is definitely changing, and there can be a lot of factors involved in that. I think the interesting thing is if we can come to an understanding where we can actually manipulate the communities, that we can engineer the communities perhaps into a more healthy state, if we're talking about human disease and so on. But for that to happen, we need to know much more about how bacteria interact with each other in these communities. But communities can change, I would say.
Yeah.
And we just don't yet have the ability to make the change ourselves.
But how do they adapt, for example, if you have a wound and a terminal chronic wound or the cystic fibrosis lung? How do bacteria adapt to these otherwise sterile places where you don't have a natural microbiota?
I think it's very important to remember that if they come from the environment, they come from these very changing environments, as I also talked about before, and then they go into a very specific environment. So they lose a lot of functions and they gain some functions that make them better at surviving in this specific area. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, it can also be biofilm formation, that they instead of maybe living... They also do biofilms in nature, but they can also live as single cells, where here, in order to survive, they have to establish themselves in these sort of very compact structures. So that can be one way. They can also produce compounds that can fight the immune system, or things like that.
Mm-hmm. Should we fear this easy adaptation of bacteria to new places? I mean, it's good that we have them on the skin and in the gut. That's what we're talking about. But suddenly, will they... And also we have 10 times as many bacteria in the human body as we have human cells. Will they take over? Should we fear it now?
So bacteria, they will adapt to new environments, and they will just do that. Also, when we try to fight them with antibiotics, mm-hmm. that's the one example that you have evolution of resistance. So that's, of course, something that raises some concern, that, mm-hmm. that our ability to fight off these bacteria are becoming less efficient. But at the same time, if we begin to understand more about the mechanisms, how do they actually adapt to these new environments, not just maybe the antibiotics, but also the nutrients and the immune system, if we're talking about infections, how do the bacteria adapt to these selective forces? Maybe that will also open up for new opportunities for devising or developing new treatments to target other processes than the ones that we're used to target.
Yeah, that leads me actually. Yeah.
Oh. I just wanted to add that I think it can also open up the possibility of thinking a little bit out of the box in order to prevent infections, for instance, by adding some bacteria that we know could be beneficial in the area. I think it's a very sort of unsafe area that we have to look a lot into, but actually thinking about could we add some beneficial bacteria places where we don't think that they are, but maybe it doesn't matter whether we have some good ones that can protect so the bad ones are not coming in. So a lot of alternative strategies can be included if we look at these things.
Yes, so I don't think we should fear it. I think we should maybe look at it as there will be new opportunities opening up for us to manipulate bacteria.
Mm. Okay, so if we understand the microbiota of the human body and understand what actually goes on out in the environment, all these places, and start to understand the negative and positive relations. We can maybe exploit the bacteria instead of they always become resistant to antibiotics. Maybe at least at some point we'll get an upper hand. What do you think?
I would think it will become a ongoing battle, so there will be no quick solution or simple mm-hmm. solution or one solution. So there will be probably a range of different strategies and methods that we keep on exploring.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any final comments, Mette?
I just wanted to add to that maybe that you could think about whether you wanted to work with or against evolution, whereas mm-hmm. when you use antibiotics all the time, what you do is actually just select for the resistance one. So you're trying to, you're not working with mm-hmm. with the evolution and selection sort of, because you're just selecting for something that you really don't want. So instead, maybe you should use alternative strategies where you depend on trying to use the good things in the bacteria instead of trying to inhibit the bad things. So, mm-hmm. so I think that's part of the same study.
All right. Thank you both.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks.